disciples, and he's actually holding a child. This is the second half of the story we heard before, where he took the child and put it around, and he's holding a little toddler and talking, teaching his disciples. And they're saying, you know, John is saying, and I don't know if it's recorded by Mark that John said it, he's saying, you know, somebody was casting out demons, apparently successfully, using Jesus' name. We tried to stop him because he can't, you know, follow us. Like, he should be following us so he can go. And Jesus said, no, that's not what this is. That's important. That's just held in. Not in the tent. Why is he doing this? And he begins to teach them about what all of this means, using this child. And one thing we've gotten over this summer is thinking Jesus is dainty. Right? He is not a dainty guy. He talked about being body and blood, being the bread of life, in words that we learn were gnashing and chewing and gulping words, right? He called the Syrophoenician woman a bad name, and her daughter a bad name before. And he talked recently about what goes in versus what goes out and what is defiled in such a graphic way that our lectionary cuts it out because it's not nice for church. So he's not dainty, and he's not being dainty today. Cut off your hand, cut off your foot, gouge out your eye if you are going to sin. But it's a certain kind of sin he's talking about, not just any old sin. Not just the sins that we all commit all the time, but a certain kind of sin. So let's look at that sin. We want to dismiss him when he uses hyperbole like this, but I want to say he never says or does anything accidentally. Never does something accidentally, and he never leaves something out accidentally. So here he is being very hyperbolic, and we need to pay attention to why, because he has a reason. And before I get started on this analysis, I want to tell you that I found a commentary that I love. It will be in the text version of this sermon online. The website where you can read about it is Caroline Lewis. She is the associate professor of homiletics of preaching at Luther Seminary. So some of this is from her work, and I encourage you to look at it and look her up. Let's think for just a minute about toddlers. All right, now I'm talking little, 18 months old, maybe two. If you've been around a really small child, what you see in them is wholeheartedness, right? They don't care about status. They don't care what you're wearing. They don't care what your job is. They don't care what you drive. They know you have one of those dratted car seats, whatever you're driving. They don't care about that stuff. They don't compete with each other for status. They don't get caught up and who's right, who's wrong in this argument, or who has more, who has less, except, you know, cookies. They don't care. They're about one thing, wholly doing what they are doing, whether it's napping, playing, getting into your stuff, throwing a temper tantrum. They are fully present in whatever it is they're doing. They don't stand off in the corner and go, "Hey, oh, you know, my dad bags are out more. What's yours?" They don't care about that. They're meeting them. And they have a goal. Their goal is to be wholly and completely who they were created to be. If you watch a toddler for any amount of time, to be fully who they were made to be. Thinking about that, because that's what God calls us to do with Him. Lay aside all the junk and fully and completely learn how to be present with Him. Be enchanted by Him. Seek our relationship with Him. So thinking about that topic, thinking about returning to being wholehearted about God and our walk with Him, let's think for just a minute about you. Each one of you. Because here's the thing. There's only one you. Throughout all this big universe, there's only one you. There is only ever going to be one you. You were made by God to be unique. Each one of you was made by God to fill a place in His universe that no one else can fill. What happens if somebody shuts you down? What if we lost? If someone abuses you, assaults you, tells you you don't belong, that you're not a full citizen of God's kingdom, what do we lose? Something irreplaceable is what we lose. And in our wholeheartedness, in our attempt to be the people God has called us to be the unique people that God made, often other people shut us down. I think we've all seen that. I think we've all experienced that. And I think we've all done that. That is what Jesus is talking about today. And He goes back and forth. Be like that child. Do not give up who you are before God. Do not give up your relationship with God. Don't let anyone make a stumbling block in front of you. And at the same time, do not do that. If you find you have, you need to turn around, repent, speak it, confess it, get forgiveness, change. Don't do it. If a person does do it fully and completely does that to another who is seeking God, they might as well just go on a hill. That's what they are promoting now. A life without unique people that God needs. It's a pretty hyperbolic message. And you know, everybody, he says everybody is salted with that fire. We all do that at times. We experience it, and we should be allowed to tell our stories of having it happen to us, and we do it to people at times. Everybody. You know, you've heard me say, I like to say, if anybody is doing it perfectly, knock it off. You're ruining it for the rest of us. Because nobody really can do this perfectly. That's why Jesus needed to come. To help us with it, because we can't do it on our own. That's the message of today. That's an important message. Which one of us doesn't have someone in our lives that saving them, if it meant losing them, we would do it? Which one of us doesn't have someone we love so much that we would give up our fill of our eye and pay for them and forgive them who they are? We all, sometimes that is not that much hyperbole at all. Because we all have someone like that in our lives. It's something that He's calling us to attend to in ourselves. So we need to ask ourselves,